Without objection, so ordered. Clerk will report.
The Senator from Georgia, Mr. Chambliss, for himself and others, proposes an amendment number 3816 to amendment number 3739.
Mr. President, I would ask unanimous consent that further reading of the amendment be dispensed with.
Without objection.
Mr. President, first of all, let me thank the chairman, and he's exactly right. I would encourage all of those who have indicated to me they would like to speak on my amendment from both sides of the aisle to let us know, come down to the floor. We'd like to dispose of this amendment as soon as possible, and I'm prepared to enter into any kind of reasonable time agreement as soon as we get an idea of exactly how many speakers there will be and in order to accommodate those folks. Mr. President, I'm going to talk in detail about the amendment, but first of all, I do want to respond to the Senator from North Dakota, who makes some good points that I agree with. But when we talk about the elimination or the not allowing credit default swaps, let me just say what bothers me about that. In 2000, when we passed the Commodities Futures Modernization Act, nobody envisioned that credit default swaps would mushroom like they did. And the fact of the matter is that not only did they grow larger in number, they grew in dollar volume, and they grew in a way that certainly did participate in the collapse that occurred in 2008. But the real problem with it is not that we had those products on the market, but that the regulators didn't have the power and authority and the tools to deal with those products. And rather than thinking about eliminating a specific product, knowing that these smart folks who are in this business, in the financial industry of this country, are out there right now looking at this bill and trying to figure out other products that they can design that will be different from a credit default swap and come forward with that, but yet be just as dangerous as what happened in 2008, that we need to give the regulators the power and authority to look at these products and put that 100% transparency in place that I want to see and that my chairman, Senator Lincoln, wants to see, and I think everybody in here agrees we ought to have.
Mr. President, would the Senator yield for a clarification?
Sure.
Mr. President, let me just clarify that
Senator from North Dakota.
That my position is to ban what are called naked or synthetic credit default swaps, not ban credit default swaps. Those with no insurable interest of any kind are considered naked credit default swaps, and it appears to me that 70% to 80% of all credit default swaps are in that category. They have no insurable interest. So I didn't want the Senator to think that I want to ban credit default swaps. That's not the case. Naked credit default swaps, yes.
Yeah, and I understand that, and my point is the same, though, that if we give the regulators the authority to regulate those, that's what will happen, because that product is not a product that has been a benefit that we're going to be talking about as we continue to debate this. But if the regulators have the authority to stop that product from coming to market, then I think we can deal with it better that way than targeting specific products to be eliminated or banned. Mr. President, among the many complex issues that this body deals with every day, there are few more complicated than the issue of derivatives. However, we should not let the complexity of the swaps market be an excuse for ignoring good public policy and ensuring that our markets are both safe as well as functional. In the past couple of years, a lot of people have become acquainted with one particular type of derivative known as we've just talked about, a credit default swap, or CDS, which permits one party to transfer the credit risk or bonds or syndicated bank loans to another party. Since AIG was heavily involved in CDS, it seems simple enough to just blame swaps generally for what went wrong in the system. However, that would be an inaccurate oversimplification because the real situation is much more complicated. We need to distinguish between credit default swaps and the actual underlying assets represented by these swaps. In this case, mortgage-backed securities on mortgages that were themselves the root of the problem. There are so many other types of swaps that U.S. businesses rely on every day to mitigate just about any risk they face in the ordinary course of doing business. Before we make a big policy change that makes these over-the-counter products less desirable to market participants, or require that these products trade only on an exchange-type facility, we need to ask ourselves whether this will even address the underlying problem. Why take a chance in these uncertain times to make legislative and regulatory changes that could possibly make things worse, potentially dry up more capital, or force the cost of business going higher? This does not mean that there isn't room for improvement, and that is why I've joined with several of my colleagues today in developing an amendment to apply strong and reasonable regulation to the derivatives markets. Let me be clear. We share a desire to apply stronger safeguards in these markets, to regulate swap market participants, and to ensure that swap transactions are more closely monitored by the regulators. I am absolutely convinced that the market volatility and financial meltdown of the recent past makes the case for more market transparency. How can we in the Congress be sure of the outcome of sweeping reforms without first properly identifying the exact cause of these problems? And how can we identify the cause of the problem without authorizing and requiring more transparency through the collection of necessary data? For this reason, I have worked with several of my colleagues to develop an amendment that would require that all swap transactions be made known to the appropriate regulators so that effective regulation can be applied where necessary. Additionally, there will be public dissemination of prices and volumes of completed swap transactions in order that investors and other market participants might be assisted in marking existing swap positions to market, making informed decisions before executing future transactions, and assessing the quality of transactions they have executed. Beyond requiring more transparency, I also believe that we should provide the CFTC and the SEC with the necessary authorities to more appropriately regulate those market participants who are potentially contributing to the type of risk that jeopardizes our financial system. Swap dealers, Fannie Mae, Freddie Mac, large hedge funds, and AIG-type entities. Many may not even realize that swaps are statutorily excluded from the current regulatory oversight of both the CFTC and the SEC. That's right. Current law does not provide for clear regulation of swap market participants. Our amendment will ensure that these market participants are fully regulated and that their swap positions are cleared through a fully regulated clearinghouse. This is a huge departure from current law. Speaking of clearing, we need to determine how best to encourage the clearing of certain derivative products without jeopardizing either the use of these risk management tools or the sustainability of our clearinghouses. For that reason, our amendment would enable true end users, those businesses who use swaps, to hedge their risk, not for speculative purposes, but true hedging to avoid an expensive mandate to clear their swaps. These businesses had absolutely nothing to do with the financial crisis and should not be punished with increased costs and burdens. We certainly do not want to discourage them from managing their risk, especially not in the current economic environment. Just last Friday, the Department of Labor published their unemployment report for the month of April. And again, unemployment rose from 9.7% to 9.9%. In my state, it's in excess of 10%. Why would we subject U.S. companies to expensive mandates when we should be advancing policies that lessen their financial burdens so that they can employ more people? Why is Congress considering slapping an additional cost on them in the form of a clearing mandate? This just doesn't make sense when these individual companies are the true end users of the products that they're trading in, and they were absolutely not the cause of the financial meltdown. These mandates should be targeted in such a way to lessen the risks of those large financial institution swap dealers who are responsible for the bulk majority of all swap transactions and therefore contributing to systemic risk. But a clearing mandate is not appropriate for businesses using swaps to manage their risks and keep their costs down. This is very simple. If their costs go up, they will either pass it along to consumers or stop managing their risk, and then they certainly cannot afford to hire more workers. So our amendment has a more targeted clearing mandate designed to reach those who are actually responsible for this crisis that we're in, Wall Street, and not Main Street businesses. The Senate will soon have the chance to vote on this substitute amendment on derivatives. I'm looking forward to further debate on our amendment because I think it will highlight the handful of significant differences between the derivatives language in the Dodd-Lincoln Amendment versus our amendment. I believe that our approach on transparency, on clearing, on end users, on capital requirements, and on trading mandates are much more appropriate, much more reasonable, much more business-friendly, and frankly, much more secure. My amendment will ensure that Main Street businesses will still be able to appropriately use derivatives in hedging their daily business risks while ensuring that appropriate regulatory standards are put into place for the institutions and transactions that contribute to the systemic financial risk. If Congress is truly interested in addressing the problem as opposed to politicizing a solution, we can no longer ignore the complexities of these markets. We must seek to understand the legitimate purposes these complex instruments serve for large and small businesses in each of our states. Unfortunately, the language currently before the Senate misses the mark when it comes to the appropriate regulation of derivatives. The underlying bill will have many unfortunate consequences, some intended, some unintended, resulting from applying complicated regulations too broadly, and will subject our American businesses to more risk, not less. Three consequences of the underlying bill on derivatives are this. One, the users will pay huge clearing fees and pass on those expenses to consumers. Two, no longer will businesses use the derivatives market, and they will pass on the higher, unstable market costs to consumers. And third, these businesses, instead of using U.S. clearinghouses or U.S. markets, will simply take their products offshore. And just as they do today, they will trade in the dark and no U.S. regulator will ever see what they're doing. That's not right. That's not what any of us intend to see happen. But the fact is that if we pass the derivatives provisions in the underlying bill, there are going to be a significant number of end users who take their business offshore. That truly is unacceptable. Our amendment makes good business sense and good common sense. Mr. President, we have received support on our amendment from a wide array of businesses around the country. These aren't banks that stand to make profits. These are individual users. I have a letter from the National Association of Manufacturers which states, and I quote, "We have serious concerns that the current end-user exemption in S-3217 and in the pending Dodd substitute is not strong or clear enough. In addition, other provisions in the derivatives title could effectively eliminate the exemption for many companies and in some cases subject them to capital and margin requirements or higher costs. Conversely, the Chambliss-Shelby substitute includes a clear and strong end-user exemption that appropriately exempts businesses that use OTC derivatives to hedge their business risk from the regulatory scheme applicable to swap dealers. From the Coalition of Derivative End User, we have the following, that my amendment would strike the right balance between bringing fundamental and needed reforms to the over-the-counter derivatives market while also ensuring significant and burdensome new costs are not necessarily imposed on business end users. Lastly, I have another letter signed by several energy supply groups that they remained concerned about the potential impact of the proposed financial reform legislation on end users. They go on to say that due to the broad definition of swap dealer, end users may be ineligible for the end user exemption if they engage in hedging business risk in the ordinary course of business. And I would ask unanimous consent, Mr. President, that these respective letters be entered into the record.
Without objection.
Mr. President, I would close at this point just by saying that, I've had numerous discussions with both the chairman of the Banking Committee as well as a ranking member of the Banking Committee and the chairman of the Ag Committee about this issue for weeks and months. And I know that we have the same goal in common, and that's to ensure that there's transparency in the marketplace and that we have regulators who are going to do the job that we ask them to do. And frankly, I'm not sure that was the case 5 years ago or even 2 years ago. But if we give these regulators the tools and if we give them the opportunity to look at every transaction, irrespective of whether it's going through a clearinghouse or whether it's over the counter, and they have the opportunity to review every large institution or every small institution that engages in these transactions, and they also have the opportunity to look at the other side and see which companies are using these products or which entities are using them, and they can then deal with those entities that become systemically risky. They didn't have that power and authority before. We're going to give them that power and authority now. And I have all the trust and confidence that they will use it in the right way, and that with those tools and with that transparency and with the bringing of these trades out of the shadows and into the sunlight, then we'll be able to control the financial markets in a way that allow our end users, those who did not cause any of the problem and are not part of the problem, from being thrown into the same basket with those folks who did abuse the system and those that did become systemically risky and caused the financial meltdown that occurred. My amendment does that, and it does it in the right way, and I would urge my colleagues to support the amendment. And with that, I would yield the floor.